everyone. On my respected colleagues, seniors, I thank Bharati Medical College for giving me an opportunity to speak on this dais, and I thank all of you for being here early morning, 8 o'clock, for coming here and listening to this lecture. So, at the outset, I'm sure all of you must be encountering at least one question about osteoporosis from some patient every day. So it is a very common entity per se, and there are some misconceptions regarding the same. I would want this to be a slightly interactive session also. Suppose I just start with a simple question. What is your thought or idea about osteoporosis? So anyone, what do you think? Kaya asana. English Marathi mare mathe mathe bolu. Osteoporosis ne start hota. Okay, very good. Whereas patients ask some questions to ki osteoporosis zhalo mhanje jhis zhali. Tyala keshat kay tatya aahe ka?
Density is different after the regeneration is different.
Very good. So correct. So you said the osteoporosis per se mhanje arthritis kadhi hot nahi, dhon vegya goshti aahet. Arthritis mhanje sandhyanchi jhis. आणि ऑस्टिओपोरोसिस म्हणजे हाडांचा ठिसूळपणा. हाडांच्या ठिसूळपणामुळे हाड कमजोर होतात व त्यांचा फ्रॅक्चर होण्याची शक्यता वाढते. आणि आर्थरायटिस म्हणजे सांगायला पाहिजे सांधेची जी त्याच्यामुळे इतर बरेच काही प्रॉब्लेम येऊ शकतात. सो वी जस्ट गो अबाउट डिस्कसिंग ऑस्टिओपोरोसिस. Go by definition of WHO, osteoporosis is defined as a systemic skeletal disorder which is characterized by a reduced bone mass and microstructural impairment of bone with resultant increased skeletal fragility and an increased susceptibility to fracture. So this is the textbook for WHO definition of osteoporosis. It is a complex endocrinological disorder of bone and mineral metabolism. The hallmark of this condition is the reduced bone mass per unit volume with a normal mineral to matrix ratio. It is one of, as per the Western literature, one of the most costliest diseases that is needed to be treated. The other common entity that we commonly confuse with osteoporosis is osteomalacia. So some you might have heard this term osteomalacia. So similar to something that is seen in children due to vitamin D deficiency. In children what we get is rickets. Similar condition in adults is called as osteomalacia. In osteomalacia what happens is that the osteoid or the basic matrix of the bone is normal, but there is deficient mineralization or deficient calcium, not calcification, ossification. Or laying down of calcium into the bone. That is osteomalacia. That also leads to weakness of the bones, but it is histologically and biochemistically or completely, it's a different entity altogether as compared to osteoporosis. In osteoporosis, there is a reduction in the pore volume osteoid also. So there is a scale of reducing bone density. Best quality is normal bone. Once the amount of bone per unit volume reduces slightly, it is called as osteopenia, and when it reduces even further, it is called as osteoporosis. It goes on to severe levels, it is called as severe osteoporosis. So as it is also called as silent disease, it is underdiagnosed, undertreated, many patients are not aware because they don't come to you directly for osteoporosis. Patients may come to you for hypertension, for diabetes, for fever, chills, whatever, but no one will come to you directly specifically for osteoporosis. So it is many a times underdiagnosed. So worldwide it is very common, and as the life expectancy of humans in general increases, the incidence of or the prevalence of osteoporosis is also going to in peace. The main thing in this is there is something called, I'll talk to that, it's called as T-coma. So, so fractures related to osteoporosis. So there are various fractures that can occur as a result of osteoporosis. If the patient who is osteoporotic, who has weak bones, he or she falls down, he is likely, most likely to sustain either a hip fracture or a vertebral fracture, wrist fracture. These are the common sites of fragility or osteoporotic related fractures. However, that said and done, other location fractures can also be present due to osteoporosis. Females have a higher risk of osteoporosis because of loss of endocrine or the hormonal support after menopause, leading to severe loss of bone matrix. So this is mainly Western literature. In India, there hasn't been a database study that shows this is the incidence of osteoporosis, this is the prevalence of osteoporosis, but however said that it is expected to be more as compared to the Western literature because of the prevalent malnutrition in the general population. So in India, most of the females who are especially malnourished, well, you can assume that they have some amount of decreased bone mineral density. So what is osteoporosis? So what normally what happens in the bone? So bone is never a static structure. Bone is a very dynamic organ, similar to any other organ like liver or heart or anything. It keeps on continuously remodeling itself. So in the bone we have what is called as BRU or bone remodeling unit. In a bone remodeling unit, what we have is that there is one part which removes the old bone and the second part, that is the bone forming part, that lays down new bone in the same part. Now, you may ask why this is required. This is required so as to maintain a good quality of bone through our life. But if the same bone tissue persists there for a long time, the bone cells there over a period of time, they die out. That itself may lead to fractures. So it needs to continuously remodel itself and keep itself active. So in osteoporosis, what happens is that the laying down of new bone is lesser as compared to destruction of the bone or the normal lysis or resorption of the bone. So as I said, bone remodeling, so it is activation and bone resorption by osteoclast and laying down of new bone by osteoclasts. So it's just a theoretical discussion. So osteoclasts, they are derived from monocytes and they are phagocytic cells. Basically they remove up old bone and osteoclasts lay down new bone. So in life in general also, balance is very important. So balance is health, imbalance is illness. So you need to have a good balance between the plus and the minus. So in a norm, so basically to avoid osteoporosis or prevent osteoporosis throughout your life, you need to have a balance between the resorption and the building up of new bone. So in a normal or a young adult, this is balance. So the amount of resorption is same as that of laying down of new bone. In children, it is the other way around. In children, the laying down of new bone is more. Okay, so as the individual grows, the bones or the height of the individual increases, strength of the individual increases, everything increases. But after a certain point of time, it is roughly approximately anywhere between 25 to 30 years. Somewhere in that zone, the strength of the bone sort of stays stagnant. After that, the amount of laying down of new bone naturally starts slowing down. And so at that point it is called as peak bone mass density or peak bone mineral density. So what everyone needs to achieve, now most of us are past that age, but mainly the amount of bone strength that you have achieved in your young age is what will help you prevent osteoporosis once you are old. If from the start itself you have a very low bone quantity, if you want to say that, then with aging process due to bone resorption, eventually you are likely to develop, you are as a male patient is likely to develop osteoporosis of a more severe grade or at an earlier age as compared to an individual who has a high peak bone mass density. So as age progresses, so like any other organ, maybe apply sagyancha jasa vay vadta kesa pandri hotat sharir kamzor hota tasa hada pan halu halu kamzor hota he sagyanmadhe honarach ahe. But as I said, so by the age 25 to 30, if your peak bone mass is very good, over your entire life you may still have good bone density to prevent fragility patches. Whereas if the peak bone density is not very good, then an individual is likely to sustain a fragility patches at an earlier age. So this is the normal concentrations of bone in front of the skin. So normally it is about 400 to 500 microns in the cortex. In osteoporosis it reduces severely, and the density per cubic volume or cubic centimeter also reduces significantly to more than half in osteoporosis. So it's basically a microstructural deterioration. So the reduced numbers and thickness of the diverticulum, there's reduced connectiveness or connectivity between the two parts of the bone, there's increased resorption, there's reduced bone formation, you may have elevated levels of parathyroid hormone, and commonly what we also see is reduced vitamin D levels. This is just shows the figures on the left show a normal bone, and on the right they show that the connection between the two parts of the bone is reduced. So as is shown in here, so as the age progresses, the amount of bone reduces and the amount of void on the place where there is yellow or red bone marrow increases. As is seen in the figure on the left, so you see a high density of bone on the left side, whereas on the right side, or the one on the bottom left and right side, so if you, as the intensity of osteoporosis or the severity of osteoporosis increases, the per unit volume amount of bone will come down. So I just come to classification. So what are the different types of osteoporosis? There are mainly two different broad categories. So one is primary and the other is secondary. Primary means everyone over a period of time is going to get it. Okay, so or every individual as the age advances, he or she is going to get some amount of osteoporosis depending on his or her own peak bone mass that was achieved at a young adult age. So in that there are two types. One is type 1, that is postmenopausal, it is seen in females due to lack of estrogen mainly. There is reduced amount of bone forming, there is severe reduction in bone forming. That is why it leads to more prevalence or incidence of osteoporosis. And senile osteoporosis happens in everyone. And the secondary means in certain individuals due to certain disorders or diseases, there is increase in the resorption of the bone. So anything like long-term steroid, corticosteroid intake, anticonvulsant intake, thyroid, hypothyroidism, cytotoxic or anti-cancer drugs, hyperparathyroidism, diabetes, and many other systemic illnesses, you name it, it most probably does cause some amount of osteoporosis. So type 1, it is caused by hormonal changes after menopause. After commonly age of menopause around 45 to 48, so after that it does lead to osteoporosis. Type 2 is senile osteoporosis, which per se only senile osteoporosis will set in probably after the age of maybe 65 or 70. So in this, this is more common in males because females by this time have already developed postmenopausal osteoporosis. And vitamin D deficiency, here is the role of vitamin D. So patient has osteoporosis and he also has concomitant vitamin D deficiency, then the laying down of new bone, that will also be reduced to add to the increased resorption. Vitamin D is required for normal laying down of bone. So because of deficiency of vitamin D, there is defective mineralization also, and it leads to more amount of osteoporosis. It's just a distribution. So in vertebrae, there is equal amount of cortical and navicular bone, and in the diaphyseal bone, that is the femoral neck shaft, there is more cortical bone as compared to the metafascial or the trabecular bone. So the common fractures in osteoporosis are spine, wrist, or hip. The other common fractures are less common are humerus, ankle, pelvis. So as so now we come to what are the grades of severity of osteoporosis. By WHO standards, there are three bone masses that one can have. One is normal, second is osteopenia, and third is osteoporosis. Now this is determined based on the DEXA scan. DEXA scan means liver energy X-ray absorptiometry. So that estimates the per unit volume amount of bone, the amount of bone per unit volume. So BMD is said to be within, so as per any statistics, so a standard deviation is taken, and normal bone density is always more than minus 1. So on a scale of, on a normal scale from 0 going to plus and minus, if it is more than minus 1 towards 0, plus 1, plus 2, that is normal. Below minus 1, you start calling it abnormal. So from minus 1 up till minus 2.5, this is called as osteopenia, and below minus 2.5, it is called as osteoporosis. It is based on the T-score. So this is a DEXA scan machine. I am sure many of medical reps or other companies, you would have seen people coming to you with a portable DEXA machine. So that is not an actual DEXA machine, it is a portable ultrasound based machine. It is good for calculating it is good for screening of patients. So if you have 100 patients, it is difficult to perform DEXA scan, most importantly because of the cost involved in the DEXA scan. The whole body DEXA scan costs approximately 3,500 to 4,000, whereas the portable ones in camps usually is 3. But the portable machine is not based on X-ray, it is based on ultrasound, and it does not give very accurate or reliable results. However, it is a good screening tool, and if you do that, I mean if an individual comes to you with a report of an ultrasound based estimation of T-score, and if you find that it is low, it is in minus, below minus 2.5, it is lesser than minus 2.5, then you can advise the patient, get a common DEXA scan to establish whether or not it is actually that low or it is better in the normal DEXA scan. So this is a normal DEXA image of showing the vertebrae. They interpret all the, I mean the machine does this for you, we don't have to calculate anything. The machine calculates it automatically, showing us what is the T-score, what is the Z-score. And interpretation as I said earlier, so normal is more than minus 1. Between minus 1 and minus 2.5 it is osteopenia. Osteoporosis is below minus 2.5, and if a patient has already sustained a fragility fracture due to the osteoporosis, then it is called a severe osteoporosis. That is T-score less than minus 2.5, and patient has already sustained say intracapsular neck femur fracture or vertebral compression fracture, then it is called a severe osteoporosis. So there is something called as Z-score also, but you need not mind. It's not main thing you need to know is T-score. That is a standard evaluation tool. So as I said here earlier, as I told you about the scale, so above, so this is, if you consider it as 0, up till minus 0.1 it will be normal. From minus 1 to minus 2.5 it is osteopenia, and below 2.5, the more negative you go, the more osteoporosis it is. So what are the other investigations that we must think of in osteoporosis? So if it is a very elderly individual, especially a male, 80 years, you find that your T-score is minus 2.5, he does not have any other comorbidities, it is not recommended, it is not required, you are not required to do any additional investigations. But however, if you find a young individual who has osteoporosis and low T score, then you need to investigate whether it is due to a secondary cause that we talked about earlier. So whether it is hyperparathyroidism, whether it is some renal disorder, whether it is some thyroid problem, or any of the other causes that is leading to a secondary osteoporosis. So who should have a bone density scan? So as we said earlier, प्रत्येक पेशंटाला त्याला बोन डेन्सिटीची टेस्ट करायची का? नॉट रिक्वायर्ड. सगळ्यांचे काय लागले तर पेशंट सगळ्यांचे तपासणी करतात. पण ऍज अ रफ गाईडलाईन, सो दिस इज ऍज फॉर द वेस्टर्न लिटरेचर अगेन, सो विमेन हु आर मोर दॅन 65 एज, मेन मोर दॅन 70, दे शुड गेट अ बेसलाईन डेक्सा स्कॅन डन टू डॉक्युमेंट व्हॉट इज द बेसलाईन व्हॅल्यू ऑफ द टी स्कोर अँड देन इन्स्टिट्यूट अँड अप्रोप्रिएट treatment for the same. So postmenopausal women with clinical risk factors, adults who have a fracture and with a condition. So as we discussed earlier, a probable cause of secondary osteoporosis, you get a baseline value down. So as we said earlier, so estrogen deficiency, steroid treatment, fracture osteopenia, hyperparathyroidism, long-term diabetes, and if you want to monitor the treatment for osteoporosis. We've already established diagnosis of osteoporosis, then over a period of time, we need to evaluate whether that T score is stabilizing or it is continuing to go down. If it is continuing to decrease even further, then you may need to change your line of treatment so as to prevent it from decreasing further. Generally, the BMD test or the DEXA scan test is not recommended to be done within a span of 6 months. What they recommend is at least 1 year in between two tests, but if you want, maybe 6 months would be an appropriate time. A time interval between two DEXA scans. Definitely not less than 6 months. If there is high risk factor, so I will say 6 months you can repeat it, otherwise once a year is okay. So now we come to the treatment part. So treatment of osteoporosis. So along with treatment of the other comorbidities, other conditions, we need to start treatment for osteoporosis also. So the patient care goes. So what you need to tell the patient? So if an elderly individual comes to you, you have done a DEXA scan test, it is showing a reduced T score, then what you need to tell is you need to counsel the patient regarding the possibility of a fracture, if at all he or she falls down. So the most important thing in treatment of osteoporosis is prevention of fall. पडणे टाळणे म्हणजे फ्रॅक्चर टाळणे हे प्रत्येक पेशंटला सांगायचं. तर ऑस्टिओपोरोटिक पेशंट पडला नाही तर त्याला फ्रॅक्चर होणार नाही. खूपच ऑस्टिओपोरोटिक असेल तर एखाद्या बसल्या बसल्या पण होऊ शकतं, पण इन जनरल जर ते व्यक्ती पडले नाही तर त्यांना फ्रॅक्चर होणार नाही. ऑस्टिओपोरोसिस असेल ते पडले एक नाही तर दोन नाही तर तीन कुठे ना कुठेतरी फ्रॅक्चर होऊ शकतो. पडणे टाळणे म्हणजे फ्रॅक्चर टाळणे. दिस नीड्स टू बी टोल्ड टू ऑल द पेशंट्स व्हेरी इम्पॉर्टंटली. सो टू रिड्यूस द इन्सिडन्स ऑफ फ्रॅक्चर्स यू मस्ट ऍडवाइज द पेशंट्स, एस्पेशली इफ दे हॅव समथिंग लाईक डायबिटीज ऑर अदर न्यूरोलॉजिकल कंडिशन्स, पेरिफेरल न्यूरोपॅथी, एनिथिंग. If there is imbalance due to any reason, ataxia or anything, then there is a high likelihood of them falling down. Diabetic neuropathy is very common, so in all your diabetic patients, you must assess if the patient is having imbalance also. If the patient is having imbalance, then it is advisable to tell the patient, kathi vapara, walker vapara, kathi vapara. If the patient is using a stick, the chances of him or her falling are pretty significant. So as per the National Osteoporosis Foundation, they have given some guidelines for treatment of osteoporosis. So one is universal, that is, so you tell everyone, all the entire population, to take basic precautions to prevent osteoporosis. So you diagnose the osteoporosis, you monitor the osteoporosis, and then you treat the osteoporosis. So the universal recommendations. So universal recommendations is basically mainly supplementation and a general lifestyle modification. So I'm sure most of us do tell this to our patients, the कैल्शियम युक्त पदार्थ जास्त खाणे, अंडी पेशंट इट्स नॉनव्हेज एग्स नॉन व्हेजिटेरियन फूड इज अ गुड सोर्स ऑफ कॅल्शियम अँड व्हिटॅमिन डी बट अदरवाइज प्लेन मिल्क ऑल्सो गुड सरप्राइज बट इट नीड्स टू बी टोल्ड टू द पेशंट दॅट यू नीड टू ड्रिंक मिल्क नॉट टी बिकॉज टी कॅन विल प्रोड्यूस द अब्सॉर्प्शन ऑफ कॅल्शियम. Plain milk is what is recommended. But otherwise, supplementation wise, usually you refer at least 1 gram of 1000 milligrams or 1 gram of calcium per day, and approximately 800 to 1000 international units of vitamin D per day. A good amount of exercise is always going to help in maintaining the normal bone mineral density. Fall prevention, as I said, so fall prevention, evaluation, and training. And if at all a patient is consuming tobacco and alcohol, it will consider them regarding stopping these because long-term chronic intake of such substances will lead to development of osteoporosis. There are other advanced tools also that have come up now to assess the fracture risk of an individual. So this is by WHO itself, so FRAX, so it's a fracture risk assessment tool. So you can go online, you can type this FRAX, and they ask you for various questions, what is the age, what is the BFD, all these things. You enter all the values and then it will give you a score whether what is the 10-year probability of having this fracture in percentage wise. So you put all the values and it will give you a probability of sustaining a fracture. This is available online, but it is very in our common day-to-day practice. This is used commonly in the Western countries, but in our scenario, if you are examining 50 patients, 100 patients every day, it is not practical to every time go online, put all the values and do it. Anyways, it is there. So the benefits are it has a 10-year probability of the clinical event, that is the fracture, it is internationally recognized, validated, it is based on data, it is easily accessible on the internet. All you, but you require a BMD value, that is the Texas scan value to calculate this. So the other values are calculated immediately. Age, height, weight, all these things. Okay. So whom to treat? So according to the National Osteoporosis Forum, so women more than 65, men more than 75, we should assume that they have some amount of osteoporosis and they do require treatment for the same. So you get a TEXA scan or a DLSA absorptionability test. If you find that the T-score is less than -2.5, he or she is automatically a candidate for treatment and you start calcium supplementation or other measures. If it is between -1 and 0.2, if it is more than -1, in the normal range you don't need to start treatment for osteoporosis because it is normal, it is not reduced bone mass. If it is osteopenia, that is between -1 and -2.5, then they advise to calculate the FRAX, and if it is, if the probability is more than 3%, then you start osteoporotic treatment. But as I said, it is difficult in our day-to-day practice to calculate the FRAX score. So what are the different medications that are available for treatment of osteoporosis? So these are the different medicines I am seeing. So medical treatment. Calcium supplementation is a part of universal measures. Okay, so calcium supplementation is not taken as a treatment of osteoporosis. It is a general universal measure. So if you think, but you know that a patient has osteoporosis, automatically patient gets calcium. Minimum 1 gram per day. And vitamin D, 800 to 1000 international units per day. That is taken for granted, that has to be given. Apart from that calcium, what we need to, you can possibly give to patients for treatment of osteoporosis, this is a list of the other ones. So, hormones in females, that is estrogen, then hormone replacement therapy, calcitonin, selective estrogen receptor modulators, that is SERN, or aroxepin, biphosphonates, there are various ones, abetronate, allopurinate, presenronate, zolendronate, and the latest one, that is the parathyroid hormone analog, that is the parathyroid. So, in these, what are, which have evidence for fracture reduction? So, mainly the biphosphonates have proven in multiple studies that they do reduce the incidence of fractures at the vertebrae, non-vertebrae and hips. Teriparatide also. So as we discussed earlier, universal recommendation is for everyone. So if you think there is osteoporosis for any reason, calcium has to be given. So some milk, vitamin D fortified milk or other foods, they need to be given. And there are patients in the anti khate, non-veg khate, either with dhoop they don't even drink milk. They are at a very, very high risk of getting osteoporosis and weakness of bones and fragility of osteoporotic fractures. So after having seen all this, so you need to consider osteoporosis to be an adolescent disease with geriatric consequences. So as we discussed earlier, you achieve a peak bone mineral density or a peak bone mass at the age of somewhere between 25 to 30. And after that, due to aging process, there is some amount of bone loss and everyone is going to suffer. So, many consider it as an adolescent disease with geriatric consequences. So, if you are in adolescent age group or in the young old age, you have not achieved a very good bone mass, you are very likely to get osteoporotic fractures once you get old. After applying, bahutansh sagles kaycha polikade sa. But nevertheless, at least calcium and dhoop. So the salient risk factors or preventing factors, so exercise. So this is general lifestyle related things that we must inculcate or tell our partner, even as ourselves, we must inculcate. So good amount of exercise will improve the overall blood supply in all parts of the body, especially the weight-bearing bones. It will help the remodeling, will stimulate the osteoblasts, will increase the bone resorption or laying down. No, it will stimulate laying down of muscle. Resorption is going to continue no matter. Okay, so exercise, everything is going to help in increasing the blood supply. It will release a good amount of androgenic or metabolic steroids from the own glands. It will induce a release of growth hormone, other growth factors that will help in building up more bone. So exercise is very important. So even a normal 10-20 minutes walk, cycling, any form of exercise is good for helping in maintaining whatever bone mass we have. Diet, so as we discussed earlier, menopause.
Diet. High fiber diet.
Yeah, in general. High fiber diet.
It will reduce.
It will reduce the absorption of calcium. So if you have very high, so these are. This is not taken from the Western tradition. So, as I said, you need to increase the dietary intake of calcium and vitamin D also. So anything that reduces the overall absorption of substances from the diet is going to lead to, not in a day or two, not in a month or two, but over a very long period, it will lead to depletion of essential nutrients. So this does not mean you go and eat junk food every day. You do require a good amount of fiber in the diet. People who eat just pure veggies, only boiled vegetables, they may not get adequate absorption of essential nutrients. And as we discussed, smoking, alcohol, they need to stop. So to fight osteoporosis, you need to adopt a healthy lifestyle, you need to have a balanced diet, dairy products with vitamin D, regular exercise. What exercise, as I said earlier, weight-bearing exercises, strengthening aerobic exercises, 3 hours every week or 30 minutes, 3 to 5 times a week, walking, jogging, anything that keeps your body active, keeps, maintains your blood supply in all your parts normal, is going to help preventing osteoporosis. So primary prevention is exercise at least 3 hours per week, and we said earlier, 1 gram of calcium intake before menopause, after menopause it is 1.5 grams. 1500 milligrams of calcium per day, reduce salt intake, adequate calories, avoid skeletal toxins, avoid smoking, fight risk of fractures. So avoid at home, so in general avoid slippery floors. Even here you see everywhere we see spartan chlorine. Spartan chlorine is very slippery. Spartan about a vitrified tiles, they are very slippery, especially elderly individuals, especially if in the bathroom also they are fitted vitrified tiles, they are very slippery. There is a higher chance of them falling. You must ask them to ties the body for the bathroom, but at least you can install what is called as anti-skid mats in the bathroom to prevent a fall and install railings in the bathroom. So that if at all they are falling, they can at least hold on to that railing support and prevent the intensity of the fall. Okay, so we'll just go through some x-rays. So this x-ray shows the distal and radius fracture. This shows hip fracture. This shows fixation of the hip fracture, but due to osteoporosis, the plate tends to have backed out or failed. Fixation becomes insecure. Same here, the shaft of the pneumo fracture, when two plates were applied, not everything, but can fail. This shows a vertebral compression fracture. And vertebral compression fractures nowadays, so you can see this, right? This is the normal vertebra that is rectangular in shape. And this has become biconvex. On both sides, the height is reduced. So this is called the post fracture or biconvex compression fracture. And you can also get an anterior wedge compression fracture, where only you get a trapezoidal shape of the vertebra. Treatment wise, if the pain persists, then you can augment the strength of that fractured bone by injecting cement into the fractured bone. So that is called as vertebroplasty. And a newer technique that is available is called as balloon kyphoplasty, where we inject special needle, we inject a balloon inside, we inflate that balloon, increase the height of that vertebra, remove that balloon, and that now cavity that is formed as a result of expansion of that balloon, we inject cement. So that's called a balloon vertebroplasty or balloon kyphoplasty. So in this, you can see that the height of vertebra is slightly increased as compared to simple vertebroplasty. Common treatment strategies. So basically, you can decrease the resorption of bone or you can increase the bone formation. So how you can decrease the resorption of bone is by giving adequate hormone replacement therapy, which is not used nowadays, but common replacement therapy, castor and bifosphonate use. Most commonly what we use is bifosphonates. And to increase formation, the only thing that has been proved clinically to increase the laying down of newborn or newborn formation is parathyroid hormone or periparathyroid. No other medicine is going to actually increase the per unit bone mass of the patient. So as we discussed earlier, available treatments, calcium supplements, vitamin D, they are must hormone replacement therapy, bifosphonates and parathyroid hormone. So we just come to it one by one. Hormone replacement therapy reduces the bone mass, alleviates the perimenopausal symptoms of the patient, but it is associated with a lot of side effects. Lot of side effects of hormone replacement therapy, and the most important being the increased incidence of cancer. Uterine cancer, breast cancer risk increases. So nowadays, it is not a favored option, hormone replacement therapy. Deep vein thrombosis also increase a lot in hormone replacement therapy. So, non-hormonal therapy. So, if we cannot target hormone replacement, then non-responders will give the other drug. So, what are the other medicines? We can give calcitonin. So, calcitonin is a hormone which stimulates the osteoblasts. Okay, but the effect is very transient. So, calcitonin, it is available as a nasal spray. I'm sure many of you have used it. So, you use one puff per day, preferably early morning, as soon as the patient gets up, because that is the normal circadian rhythm or circadian cycle of calcitonin in our body. So preferably give it in the morning, one puff per day in alternate nostril. That will, till the time it is going on, it will mainly help in laying down of newborn, and mainly it will reduce the pain that is associated with any pressure fracture. So patient has an acute vertebral compression fracture, that is the ideal indication for giving calcitonin, because not only it will help in laying down some bone, but mainly it will reduce pain. Okay. Next thing that we have is the selective estrogen receptor modulators, that is SERM or haloxifen. So it is somewhat similar to, it has effects that are similar to estrogen, but it has less amount of side effects that were earlier associated with the hormone replacement therapy or the estrogens. So are the estrogens from there, sort of designer estrogens. So it is agonist against the bone, against the lipid metabolism, there is antagonist against the uterine endometrium and breast tissue. So the main side effects that we saw with hormone replacement therapy, that is an increased risk of uterine and breast cancer, is completely avoided with naloxone. And the beneficial effects of estrogen, that is aiding the bone formation and a good effect on lipid metabolism, is helped with the estrogen. But again, there are many adverse effects because it does not have complete estrogen effects. It has some of the side effects of reduced estrogen. There may be perimenopausal hot flashes. All these things are more common with naloxone. Finally, we come to parathyroid hormone. So it is the only drug which is known to stimulate bone formation. As I said, so if you want to increase the bone formation in an individual, osteoporotic individual, this is the only drug that can do that. And what is the basically, it is an anabolic effect of the bone. It increases the bone mineral density. You need to monitor it on a regular basis, and the treatment needs to be long term. You cannot just give it a single vial, commercially available, whichever company, Terifac, whatever you get. They give it as a 1 month dose. But giving teriparatide just for 1 month is not going to have very beneficial effects for the patient. So you need to give it for at least 6 months. You should only want to give it, others don't give it at all. So this is just a waste of money. So if at all it is started, you need to continue it for at least 6 months, preferably up to 12 months. After that, again monitor the bone mineral density value on the DEXA scan, and then take a call whether you want to continue it or not, stop the treatment. Okay, so it is given as subcutaneous injections. So recommended dose is 20 micrograms per day. However, in severe cases, you can increase it to 40 micrograms per day. So the main inhibiting factor is cost, it is expensive. And coming to the most commonly used anti-osteoporotic drugs, that is the bisphosphonates. So they are available as oral or injectable medications. So they are basically pyrophosphate analogs. Potency depends on the side chains or chemical formulas. So basically they inhibit the osteoclast mediated resorption of the bone. So as we discussed earlier, for treatment of osteoporosis, you can either stimulate bone formation or you can reduce the bone resorption. So this is the main drug that will help in reducing the bone resorption. Okay, so it inhibits the osteoclast adhesion, osteoclast activity, and what's the apoptosis of the osteoclast. So just a mechanism of action, and basically it leads to killing of the osteoclast, and that's why it reduces the bone resorption. But again, there are a lot of side effects of bisphosphonates also. So as we discussed in the earlier part of my lecture, so bone is not a stagnant tissue. So just reducing the amount of bone resorption is not going to lead to strengthening of the bones. You need to have a dynamic balance between the bone resorption and the bone formation. If this is disturbed, eventually bone is going to get brittle. Okay? But yes, it can be used in steroid-induced osteoporosis, long-term use, rheumatoid arthritis. So, concern that is that persistent remodeling is suppressed. So, you can get osteomalacia, you can get an increase or what we call as atypical fractures. So, after long-term bisphosphonate therapy, the normal cases where osteoporosis occurs, patient does not sustain fracture at those locations. Patient sustains the fracture at some other place. It's most commonly in the subtrochanteric region or the distal tibia region. So that is because this is mainly cortical bone, and the bone remodeling or resorption is suppressed to a severe extent. So the bone in that region becomes very brittle, and it may lead to a fracture. So even bisphosphonates you should not give for more than a year at a time. After that you need to give a, you should give an interval for at least 6 months before resuming this therapy again. Contrary, again, they also need to be monitored, especially the ones that you are giving intravenously. So zoledronic acid, which is available as an intravenous infusion, you need to admit the patient and then administer the injection very slowly over a long period. given rapidly, it can lead to sudden hypocalcemia and rarely even death of the patient. So be very careful while giving intravenous zoledronic acid. It is more advisable in common day-to-day practice to give some oral bisphosphonates. Whether it is allopurinate, bisphosphonate, that's okay. Each has caused some effects, some side effects, but more or less they function the same. But it is safer to use the oral one as compared to the intravenous ones. The other thing that you need to warn is, main thing you need to know is gastrointestinal disorders, dysphagia, esophagitis. So the most important instruction that you need to give, to the patient who is taking a bisphosphonate is, take it early morning after getting up, after brushing his teeth, and make sure that you don't lie down for at least half an hour after taking the tablet. Because if patient takes a tablet, he lies down, he has some amount of gastroesophageal reflux, and all the salicylic water, acetylcholine, that you give is going to get reflux into the esophagus. It is going to lead to a lot of esophagitis. So that needs to be avoided. That is very important instruction that you need to give. Guri Vidhan Antar Ardha Pound Plus Vasundhara Sadatha Kaipantra Zubunata. So hypocalcemia and other disturbances, if you do find a person, particular patient has some amount of hypocalcemia, then don't give him or her bisphosphonates. And if patient has severe renal impairment, then also don't give bisphosphonates. So this is a very long lecture, I understand, but it's the last lecture. Key strategies, as I said earlier, is to maximize the peak bone mass in children and adolescents. So for community practice, the most important thing is to make sure that our children, our young adults have a good diet, which is calcium rich, protein rich. They do a good amount of exercise and maintain a good healthy lifestyle. So over a period of time, you can conserve the bone mass, reduce the risk of falls, and depending on an individual patient, you can start the requisite pharmacological treatment. Okay, so as I said earlier, these are some of the online tools, if at all anyone wants to use. There are many tools, most commonly Rax tool is used, but there are others, I believe we like them. But again, in common day-to-day practice, no one uses this, at least in our part of the time. So if at all you have any questions.